Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another video. Today we're taking a look at the final prices from James Julia's Fall 2017 Firearms Auction. We'll start right in with James Ballou. He is the author of the collector grade book on the BAR, his Colt Monitor. This is not quite an original Colt Monitor. It was a parts kit from a monitor built on an original Colt 1925 receiver. Still did not prevent it from selling for just about $72,000. Holy cow. The monitor is one of the rarest variants of the BAR, and at least in my experience so far, one of really the coolest and best variants of the BAR. That was an incredibly enjoyable gun to shoot, and I would love to have one myself, but at that kind of price, it will probably be a long time. For someone who wants a 30 caliber shoulder-fired automatic rifle, well, the BM-59 was certainly another viable option for quite a lot less money. This is a pretty darn immaculate example of it. Not very many full-auto BM-59s came into the country. In fact, not a whole lot of semi-auto BM-59s came into the country before the 1989 import ban kind of shut a lot of that down. Full-autos here had to come in before 68, so pretty rare. However, one of the less popular, sort of doesn't have as much collectible value to it as a lot of other machine guns. Now, speaking of less popular, collectible, less collectible machine guns, the Bestigui Hermanos MM31, really actually a very good machine pistol, but not very well recognized, and went for really, I think, the bargain price of $7,500 for a nice, legit, functional machine pistol. Pretty cool there. Now, the Astra is definitely a better known gun, also a rarer gun, and in this case, a much better conditioned gun. I think in particular, the grips on that MM31 being basically handmade probably detracted a lot from its value, because you're going to pay about twice as much to get a select fire Astra 902. Now, has a fixed magazine, not as easy to use as the MM31. And then the really interesting one here was the semi-auto version of the 902. With its case and stock, this was a beautiful gun, an extremely rare gun. There were very few 20-round magazine semi-auto 902s. Of course, it doesn't have any NFA elements to it. It is just a semi-automatic pistol. And so that thing went for twice as much as the Bestigui, more than that, in fact, $37,500. So hopefully someone's very happy with that new pistol. Going back to a gun that doesn't look so great, this is the defaced Amnesty registered AR-15. Really, I think, a pretty interesting gun, largely for the legal history behind it and what went on regarding that 1968 amnesty. Brought $23,000, which is, I think, pretty reasonable, pretty typical, I should say, for an NFA-registered AR-15 machine gun lower. I know a lot of people are going to be curious what my Vickers gun brought. Well, $17,825. Of course, these prices are all including a 15% buyer's fee, so that's tacked on to everything you see here. So the money that I'm getting from that is almost immediately being plunged back into some other guns, so you'll see some cool stuff on those in the future. Now, there were a trio of Sturmgewehrs that we took a look at in this auction, and the first one up was an MP43/1. That's the very first version of the Sturmgewehr that the Germans issued. They're pretty cool. This was a really nice example of one, and it brought commensurately a lot of money, $34,500. The MP44, so a slightly later version. Again, all three of, well, both of these two were fully transferable Curio and Relic machine guns. This one brought a lot less money because it didn't have the rarity of that 43/1. Wasn't quite as nice of a conditioned gun, but still a really nice Sturmgewehr. What's interesting is the third one, which was actually a registered DWAT, meaning it is a deactivated gun, but can be legally reactivated if you're so inclined. That one also brought $23,000 despite being a DWAT. I think that's also because it was a pretty darn nice example of a very late war gun. You can see in particular that cool duotone, part blue, part parkerized finish to it. That was typical of some of the very late war production of the Sturmgewehrs. I think in general, there are a lot more Sturmgewehrs out there than people realize. They're a very iconic weapon, but as far as machine guns go, they are not one of the most valuable, and they are a lot more common than some others. Others like, for example, the ZB-26. This was a really nice ZB-26, and the 26 is in every way a really fantastic light machine gun. If you wanted a machine gun that is box magazine fed and full rifle caliber, it would be really hard to seriously recommend anything as being better than a ZB-26. Really, the only contenders would be the ZB-30 and the Bren gun, both of which are developments of the ZB-26. So this is one that was originally being made for Spanish contract. It was taken over when the Germans occupied Czechoslovakia and ended up being used by the German military instead. The German army itself didn't really use ZBs, but they did use a lot of MG-34s. Here we have another one, not quite all matching, but overall a very nice gun. And it, well, because the 34 is a more common gun on the market, it did bring less than the ZB-26. Again, 23 grand, you're kind of seeing a pattern develop here of where a lot of these World War II era collectible machine guns go. MG-15 kind of fell into the same sort of area, a little bit less, 20,700. This one was really neat because it did come with all of the accessories to turn this from an aircraft gun into a ground gun configuration. And that's really neat to see. And also that magazine on it is a really difficult to find magazine. That, in fact, may have both contributed to why it brought as much as it did, and also why it didn't bring more. It's not quite so much of a good shootable gun as an MG-34 is, for example, because it's just hard to find magazines, etc. A quick interlude for a toolkit here, which I'm not even going to try and pronounce in German, to repair your 34 or perhaps your MG-15 should you need it. That brought way more than I was anticipating, $4,000 for the toolkit. Now, it was in gorgeous condition, so that probably has something to do with it. Going back to some machine guns, this was one of the first times I'd been able to actually get my hands on a transferable Madsen light machine gun. Most of the ones out there are dealer samples, and I think because this is kind of an obscure gun, it doesn't have a really notable place in any major wars that people understand. It didn't bring all that much money, relatively speaking. There's a good budget light machine gun for someone who was looking for one. Definitely not on the budget end would be a BAR. This one being a model of 1918 and a really fantastic condition one. It's much more difficult to find a transferable and intact 1918 than it is the 1918 A2, which is the version the U.S. used in World War II. So this one was cool to take a look at, and I'm sure someone will be very happy with it. Super Bazooka was a completely deactivated piece, which means there is no legal bringing it back. Also means there's no NFA paperwork involved. You just buy that thing and take it home like it's a piece of plumbing pipe. But it's a really cool piece of plumbing pipe. So I think someone probably got a pretty good deal on that. It's a neat example. We have a couple machine guns that didn't sell, one of them being the port firing weapon. Typically, this means that the reserve was placed too high. I don't know what the reserve was on this, and I don't know what the bidding actually got to. Kind of a shame. These are pretty darn rare on the civilian market, and while they're a completely ridiculous concept of a gun, they are historically pretty neat. The other one, which is, well, even more ludicrous of a practical gun, but even more interesting historically, was the 1907 Saint-Étienne, which I was really disappointed to see not sell. I am hoping that the owner, if he takes it back, will let someone like CN Arsenal get their hands on it to do a really good video. Lastly, at looking at the big stuff, we had the Solothurn S18-1000, went for $18,000. Definitely the Cadillac of 20mm anti-tank cannons. Having shot both that and a Lotte, I can tell you that this is definitely the nicer gun. And of course, it brought a price that was commensurate with that. Now, transitioning to some older stuff, we'll start with this basically maker unknown British 8-shot pepper box, which is interesting largely for its appearance and sheer size, went for the same amount as the Super Bazooka. So that's that bid is $1,200 plus the 15% fee. Hopefully someone will have a good time with that. Now, Civil War weapons in general are, I think, kind of on the downslope. There are fewer people interested in them these days than there were maybe 50 years ago. However, Confederate arms are still worth an incredible pile of money, as you can see from this Whitworth sniper for $161,000. Jeez. Now, the Whitworth was a very rare rifle. It has a very interesting historical place as a Confederate sniper rifle. And all things Confederate in the Civil War, at least the arms, bring a premium because there's a lot less of that out there and available than there are of Union firearms. The Union did a much better job manufacturing guns. The Confederacy had a lot of trouble with it, and so Confederate arms, here we go again, like a Morse carbine here, go for a substantial premium over union ones typically. So we have 12 and a half grand for a Morse carbine, actually really interesting with its early cartridges. And then more surprisingly, I think to a lot of people, will be 13 grand for this Keen Walker carbine, which really looked like a rusted out kind of relic of a gun. And truth be told, it was not a very good condition gun. But because it is a Confederate example, it's one that there are very few existing examples of, it can bring quite a lot of money. The Schock and McClanahan revolver, this is one of like six that were produced or known, brought 34 grand. So you have a choice between this and a nice World War II machine gun, if you want to look at it that way. This was a really nice gun, really kind of a one-of-a-kind example, actually, of Schock and McClanahan pieces. And then it was also, they were also selling a holster for it that was made specifically for a notable Confederate officer. These had been separated. I believe it was the revolver was stolen and then recovered. So the revolver was being sold by the insurance company that had paid out on the claim for it. The holster was being sold by its previous owner. Unfortunately, because of the confidentiality of the buyers and sellers at the auction, I am not allowed to say whether they went to the same person. Certainly, we all hoped that they did. There was a pair of sequentially serial numbered Carr revolvers here. They went really actually quite low for what I was expecting. I think the reason for that is while the Confederacy used a huge number, relatively speaking, of Carr revolvers, the specific documentable provenance is a little bit difficult to establish. So I don't think they got really the same bump that a lot of other Confederate arms do. There's always still this chance that, well, maybe these were just manufactured during the Civil War and not actually used by the Confederacy. We have a Butterfield Army revolver here. The price on this is $5,500 because at this point we're going back up to the North instead of the Confederacy. So still a rare, interesting, and pretty cool pistol in pretty darn good shape. So someone's going to enjoy that. And then lastly, we had a trio of Griswold and Gunnison revolvers, maybe the most common of the Confederate domestically produced revolvers from the Civil War. So going from left to right here, $23,000 was a generic, well, as much as there is a generic, a standard Griswold and Gunnison. The middle one went for 50% more because it is an iron frame example. In fact, it's the only known iron frame example. And then the one on the right went for quite a lot more because it is a presentation piece inscribed on the back strap. So a little more interest in those two than in the first one, and you can see that reflected in the prices. We will have another auction coming up soon. The next James D. Julia auction will be in the spring, so stay tuned for that, and thanks for watching.